Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we question the limits of non-physics. Today, I'm here with Jan Plefka.
Hi.
And Jasper, Roosmale and Nepveu.
Hello.
Jan is a professor in theoretical physics at Humboldt University in Berlin, and Jasper is a PhD student working with Jan. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you for having us.
Jan and Jasper study how two seemingly unrelated forces of nature may be mathematically connected through a fascinating relation called the double copy. The two forces they try to relate are gravity and the strong force. Gravity is responsible for the motion of celestial bodies like stars and planets, and it also enables us to stand on a spherical planet. On the other hand, the strong force acts at the subatomic level to bind atomic nuclei together. Without a strong force, there would be no atoms and therefore no people to study physics. But gravity and the strong force seem very different. So Jan, how are they related and why is this relation called the double copy?
Well, in our understanding of nature, fundamental forces are mediated through the exchange of particles. So a relation between the strong force and gravity translates to a relation between these elementary particles. In the case of gravity, they're called the gravitons. In the case of a strong force, they're called the gluons. Why gluons? Well, as you mentioned, at the subatomic level, the gluons are responsible for gluing the nuclei together. Now, to your question, we can understand the double copy as a relation between gravitons and gluons. And in a sense, you can think of a graviton being equivalent to two gluons moving parallel with each other through space and time. And why this is the case is still very mysterious to us.
It seems indeed very surprising that these different forces would be related. Is this what makes it so interesting, Jasper?
Yes, I find it interesting that gravity and the strong force have been studied independently for so long, long before this connection between them was found. But the double copy relation is also practically useful for physicists because it allows to do complicated calculations in gravity using simpler building blocks from the strong force. So there's certainly a lot to learn and discover in this topic of research.
Well, I'm really curious to know more. So what is the double copy? How can gravity and the strong force be related? Could it be that gravitons and gluons are deeply similar in some hidden way? Let's find out. In order to grasp the relation between gravitons and gluons, we first need to understand what these particles actually are. So Jasper, what do we know about them?
Well, fundamental particles are incredibly small, and nature at this scale is completely different from our everyday experience. So this makes it difficult to describe particles, and we cannot compare their behavior to familiar objects like footballs, for example. What we can do, however, is characterize them through a list of their properties.
By such properties, do you mean like mass and charge, for example?
Exactly. So let's take the familiar electron as an example. The electron has a mass, which means that it cannot travel at the speed of light. And the electron also has an electric charge, which means that it feels the electric force. Particles which have the same electric charge, they repulse each other, while particles with opposite electric charge, they attract. So this is what the electric force does. And knowing the charge of particles helps us to classify them. But gluons and gravitons are both massless and do not have an electric charge. So these properties cannot be used to distinguish them.
But then how do we distinguish these particles? Perhaps, Jan, could you tell us more?
Yes. There is a third property we have to look at, which is different from mass and charge, which we also know from the macroscopic world, a property that elementary particles carry, and that is the spin. We can think of it as a spin of a macroscopic object moving through space and time, like the football you talked about. Yet for an elementary particle, which is point-like, that doesn't make a lot of sense. And here quantum mechanics enters the stage. Namely, this intrinsic spin of an elementary particle cannot take any values. Their values are quantized. Only certain discrete values of spin are allowed. Spin is an angular momentum, and the electron, for example, carries spin 1/2, which means that this angular momentum carried by the electron can only take one value, and it can turn in this or the opposite direction. Now, coming back to your question, gravitons and gluons differ in their spin. gravitons have spin 2, gluons spin 1.
Okay, so the graviton is massless and it doesn't have electric charge. And on the other side, we have the gluon, which is also massless and it doesn't have an electric charge. The main difference then seems just the spin.
Exactly, but this is not just a difference. This is a key property of the double copy. The graviton has double the spin of the gluon.
So Jan, is the idea behind the double copy that combining two gluons results in a graviton because 1 + 1 = 2?
In a certain sense, that's basically the idea, indeed. Because the spin of two gluons equals the spin of one graviton. And if these two particles move together in parallel, you can think of these two gluons as one graviton.
So if we can reproduce then a graviton from these two gluons, what makes the double copy so mysterious?
Well, there's yet another property we have to discuss here, and that is beyond mass, charge, and spin, there's a third property that distinguishes elementary particles, and that is their color. Gravitons do not carry color because they are not affected by the strong force. We can think of a color as a charge of a strong force, and hence gluons are colored because they are affected by the strong force, whereas the other particles that we talked about, the electron or the graviton, are not colored because we are not subject to the strong force.
Since we are not really painting particles, why do we refer to this property as color?
That's because the color charge is more complicated than the electric charge. Instead of just plus or minus, different gluons can have different labels, and these labels are given the names of colors. But the important fact is that the value for this color label determines how the gluons interact with the strong force.
Okay, Jan, so now going back to the double copy. If I understand correctly, now gluons have a color, but gravitons don't. Is that right?
Yeah, that's right. And that's actually the reason why I said before that combining two gluons to form a graviton is not so simple. Actually, the fact that gluons carry color is not a problem, but a virtue. It paves the way to consistently double the spin of two gluons to form one graviton. Let me try to explain that. The double copy manifests itself when we study scattering experiments. Namely, when we take two gluons, shoot them in a collider at each other, have them scatter off each other and produce two new gluons. Such experiments are being done at the LHC in Geneva, for example. We can compute the probability for this process to happen with gluons, and it turns out that this computation has all the ingredients in it to do the same computation, the same scattering experiments involving gravitons that shoot at each other and they come out. Although I should say that this is a Gedanken experiment, as we do not have access to graviton colliders, but we can still do the computation.
Okay, but then what's the role of color in scattering, Jasper?
Right. If we are describing a collision of gluons, the prediction of what happens depends on two things. On the one hand, we have the color of the involved gluons, and on the other hand, their precise motion and spin. The precise motion and spin of the particles are together called the kinematic information. And it turns out that, surprisingly, the color information of the process and the kinematic information have exactly the same structure. And it's this remarkable fact, which is called the color kinematics duality, that allows for the double copy.
It sounds indeed really remarkable. Is it obvious that the color and the kinematics should have a corresponding structure, Jan?
Oh, no, not at all. In fact, physicists have been studying the theory of the strong force for decades before they even realized that it hides this absolutely fascinating property. In fact, first hints arose in string theory, yet the full color kinematic duality was only exposed in 2008 by Bern, Carrasco, and Johansson.
Is this then would finally allow us to double the spin of the gluons in a consistent way?
Exactly, Giulia. So if we consider the scattering of two gluons, we have two building blocks, a color part and a kinematical part. The kinematical part carries the information on the motion of the gluons. Now, if we take this kinematical part and double it, and replace the color part by another kinematical part, so we double the kinematical information, then we receive the probability for the scattering of gravitons. And that is why we call it a double copy.
It is fascinating that information on color and kinematics has the same structure, why they seem so unrelated. Could it be that this points us towards a deeper connection between the strong force and gravity?
Yes, but that is hard to say, of course, but it's a very interesting question. In any case, the double copy is a very useful mathematical trick that allows to do calculations in gravity that are useful for the observations of gravitational waves. But yes, I would say that it is our job as theoretical physicists to look for explanations of such surprising structures in our theories of nature, such as the color kinematics duality and the double copy.
I fully agree, Jasper. In fact, understanding these surprising relations could help us in our quest for understanding the fundamental nature of the interactions in physics, and in particular, to unravel the mysteries of the quantum nature of gravity. One such proposal is string theory, which replaces the concept of point-like particles by little strings wiggling with energy. While this theory is still speculative, as it cannot be tested experimentally at this point, the double copy is naturally and beautifully geometrically built in. Namely, the open strings correspond to gluons and the closed strings correspond to gravitons. And you can combine two open strings to form a closed string. And when you look at these objects from far apart, they correspond to the gluons and gravitons we've been talking about today.
It is really intriguing, and it would be amazing if the double copy could lead us to a better understanding of our universe. Thank you very much, Jan and Jasper, our double J's, for giving us such a nice explanation of the double copy.
It was a pleasure.
A double thanks from our side.
And thanks to you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.